So welcome everyone to a long and tedious parsha, Truma, which talks a lot about measurements of all the vessels of the Mishkan and all the different specifications. So it might be an architect's dream parsha, but for most of us humans, it's very long, tedious, and dare I say, boring. Why did the Torah have to go into so much detail with regards to all the measurements and how to build the walls and how to space them out? And I want to show you that the Torah didn't have to do it. So let's see where the Torah did do it and then where they didn't do it. So and when it's describing the walls of the Mishkan, make 10 strips of cloth, make this, etc., the length of each cloth, 28 cubits, width, etc., 5 of the cloths joined to one another, make loops, okay, 50 loops. Okay, let's take the menorah, the candelabra. Here, you shall make a lampstand of pure gold, 6 branches, and each branch what it needs to have, etc., etc. But not all of them are like that. So I want to show you one where the Torah actually gave free license to the builders. Okay, so this is the basin, the keel, or sometimes called the laver. Do you see 3 different pictures?
Yeah.
So this is from Park Timna in Israel. They think it looked like this. Machon HaMikdash, an institute in Jerusalem that studies the artifacts of the temple, they think it looked like this. And the Mennonites, I visited them once, they have a museum in Pennsylvania where they have replicated all the vessels of the tabernacle. And this is from their museum on the left. This is Ethan Kelly. And now, why is there so much differentiation? Because this is all what the Torah says about it. Make a laver of copper and a stand of copper for it, for washing. Place it between the tent of meeting and the altar. Put water in it, and there you go. And start using it. No measurements, no specifications. Okay, so now it begs the question. So then why couldn't the Torah say the same thing about all the other vessels and all the other aspects of building the tabernacle, right? It did leave a lot of room, which we see in the different pictures and the different ideas that people had when they tried to replicate the keel, the basin. Why couldn't they do it? And so that leads me to suggest that we need to go into this. The details have a purpose. We can learn some things from the details. Now, why did I call this Porgy and the Poles? Okay, so the poles are the poles that you see here that were used to carry the vessels. But who is Porgy?
From Porgy and Bess.
Ah, excellent. So you and my mother are always ahead of everybody else, 2 steps ahead. Yes, I was thinking of Porgy and Bess and a specific song in Porgy and Bess, and we're going to get to that. How is that connected to our parsha? The song is, it ain't necessarily so. Okay, so first we'll study one aspect of the details of our parsha, and then we'll connect it to Porgy and Bess. So let's look at the Shulchan, the table of the showbread. A lot of specifications. I picked one specification, and that is the poles. That's our subject today. And the Torah says, Vasita tabadim asei shitim, tzipita otam zahav. Make the poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold. By these, the table shall be carried. So you put rings. I didn't quote those verses. The Torah says also, install 4 rings, which you can see here. And they actually made bread on this table. And this bread was eaten by the priests, by the Kohanim. So it makes sense. It's heavy and you need poles to carry it. Let's move on to the next vessel, the incense altar. There were 2 altars in the tabernacle. One called the incense, where they did the ketoret, also called Mizbach HaZahav, was made out of gold. Here too, Vasita and Tabadim and Seishitim and Sipital Tam Zahav. Make the poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold. Okay, so, and rings, of course. I didn't quote that verse. Let's move on. Then there were two altars. This one is the one in the courtyard where they did the sacrifices. This is where all the action, the hardcore action of sacrifices and burning the animals, and some of them was burned totally, some of them was like a steak, was actually dinner for the Kohanim. So this is called Mizbach HaNechoshet, made out of copper. And also the poles also were overlaid with copper this time. So again, to make it clear, what was the purpose of these poles? The poles shall be inserted into the rings so that the poles remain on the two sides of the altar when it is carried. Okay, and now finally we get to the ark. And it seems like it's the same. You should do asita badei atzeishiti, make poles of acacia wood. Ve'evetai tabadim batabaot al salot ha'aron. Then insert the poles into the rings on the side of the walls of the ark for carrying the ark. So far, it sounds very similar to all the previous vessels that we saw, right? Nothing special. However, the Torah here adds one more verse that we don't find anywhere else. Verse 15. So we have 13, 14, and now comes 15. Betabot ha'aron yiyu abadim lo yasuru mimenu. This is so important. We have a volunteer to read the English.
Okay, the poles shall remain in the rings of the ark. They shall not be removed from it.
Ah, so for the first time, we actually have is it a recommendation or a prohibition or an instruction? Don't remove the poles. We didn't have that in any of the other vessels.
It's a command.
What do you think? Is it now why don't we have in the menorah? Because I think center of gravity, it's too thin. You see, I just showed this picture in order to, I think there's a very practical reason why the menorah did not have poles. It would tip over, right? Think about it. All the others have a large base, and which makes sense. It would be stable. If you put two poles on the center branch of the menorah, it would fall. It would tip over. Just I think, I look at it and I feel it. And indeed, okay. So that there, I think there's a reason.
Kosher menorah.
What?
The menorah, it doesn't look kosher. The Shabbos is not taller than the other candles. Okay. Oh, that's why it's okay.
Yeah, no, it's seven. In the Mishkan, it was seven. Yeah. So I think that's a practical center of gravity problem there. But let's go back to the ark. When you look at them, they look, the ark, the altar, the table, they look as if it's all the same idea, but we just saw the verses. No, the poles here, it's different. The Torah specifically said, don't remove the poles. So what do you say? Recommendation or prohibition?
Well, it's more than a recommendation. It's a command. Got to do it.
So some of the great rabbis who codified the mitzvahs think like you, Natalie. It's codified as one of the 613 mitzvot. Sefer HaChinuch, we'll see in a second. For him, it's mitzvah number 96. The Rambam, he also had a codification called Sefer HaMitzvot, which he wrote. And in his list, it's negative mitzvah number 86. So absolutely, don't remove it. It's a prohibition. I like to say that this is the mitzvah that the entire Jewish people have performed with no violations, zero violations throughout our history. I don't think anybody has ever removed poles from the ark. So we can be proud that this is one mitzvah that we have all fulfilled meticulously. Okay? And as you saw, it is a mitzvah. It's one of the 613. Okay, but now I want to ask why. Why did the Torah say they must be permanent, even though the tabernacle moves from place to place? And you would think, okay, once we settle in a place, especially if it's going to be a long time, why not remove the poles?
Because if the Jews are attacked, you're not going to want to be fiddling around sticking poles through holes. This is the ark. God is living in there, and you got to run fast.
So now that gives a practical reason. I made a table here that I want to fit, and I called the left column, the white, is the practical reasons, and And the blue will be if we can find some symbolic reason to it. So now that he says, in case of emergency or fast, quick departure.
Yeah.
Right? We don't have time. And this is, okay. So this is very similar to what Avigail came up with. And I called it the important documents theory, which is very similar to what you're saying, Natalie. So You can't save everything in your house. Your house is on fire. You need to have, right, the passports, the birth certificates, ready to grab and go. You won't be able to take everything that you see on the right, but you might be able to save, you know, a couple of the important documents. And so Natalie and also Abigail are saying, that's the Aron, that's the Ark. It has the tablets. God's words, living words are there. That must be saved. That needs to be ready all the time. Okay, here's my question on that theory. So why not keep the polls on all the other ones? Why not keep the polls? If maybe we'll have time to save the table, the altar. Why not? I mean, okay, maybe we won't have time, but it doesn't hurt to keep them there. Why not? How does it hurt to just leave the polls there, inserted the whole 40 years?
It shows that they're replaceable.
Explain.
Well, the Ark is not truly replaceable with its contents. The menorah, the golden altar, the table of showbread and such, those items could be rebuilt. We have directions for them.
Ah.
But okay. The golden Ark cannot be rebuilt by us and filled by us. And one of the questions that comes to mind with the golden Ark is the cherubim that are there. We are told early on not to make any graven images. And yet, effectively, they are, just like on our in our shul, on the left and right of the area, there are two three-dimensional images, which are animal-like and could probably be called by somebody graven images.
That's a great question. So I think that the traditional understanding of that prohibition is don't make any graven images unless I tell you to do so. Unless explicitly okay, permitted.
Do we get direction from Hashem for the setup of our shul?
Okay. So I think also it inhibits the worship, the actual use of the, if you keep them, think about it. Look at this table, or I have a better picture. Look at this. If you keep the poles all the time, how are you going to use the table? It really inhibits the use. Same thing with the altar. And this altar too. So for convenience, you need to actually remove them. But then comes the Ark. Of course, you don't remove them. Also, because we don't really, there's no use. There's no, the one time a year, the Kohen Gadol goes into the Holy of Holies and comes close to the Ark. That's the only use of it. So it doesn't need to be used in the traditional sense. And also we want to be able to save it in case we quickly have to move. So that's a practical reason. Our commentaries have also suggested, and Sefer HaChinuch also has a practical reason. Do I have a volunteer to read it?
Okay, therefore we were commanded not to remove the poles of the Ark from it, lest we need to go out with the Ark to any place quickly, and maybe due to the preoccupation and the rush, we will not check well that its poles are strong enough, and lest, God forbid, it will fall from their hands, and this is not fit for its glory. But with their always being ready and not being removed from it, we will make them very strong, and so there will not be a mishap with them.
Okay, thank you. So where should we put that reason in our table?
That's practical.
Okay, absolutely. So I say, avoiding mishap. And actually, there's a story in the book of Judges where the ark fell and the person who carried it died with Uzzah. There's a whole story there. So we know that it's very dangerous if the ark falls. So to avoid that, the Sefer HaChinuch has a great explanation. Avoiding preventing accidents. Okay. The Tosafot, sometimes called Dad's Kenim, Ibadat Tosafot, students of Rashi around the 12th, 13th centuries, they say the extra holiness of the Ark mandates that people don't often touch it. So, what in essence, they are saying that the permanent poles prevents unnecessary fiddling with it. So not so much concern about accidents, but just it's holy. Don't mess around with it. Don't fiddle with it unnecessarily. If you have to attach and remove poles each time, that's extra fiddling with it, and it's not befitting for the holiest object that people will constantly be fiddling with it. So where should we put that reason?
Practical.
Okay, so you guys say practical. So let's add it here. So avoid fiddling with the holiest object. Okay. All right. The Meiri says something interesting. Fusion of physical and spiritual. So they need to be permanent. Do you guys see the Meiri? Yes. Okay. So the poles are representative of man's physicality. The ark and the tablets that were in it represent man's spirituality. And so the idea of making them permanent and never removing those poles is that man's physical and spiritual dimensions are meant to be fused. We don't shun the physical. We're not ascetic in that sense. We don't say don't enjoy life at all, but we need to blend the physical and the spiritual, and that's the reason for making this permanent fusion of the poles to the ark. So where should we put that reason?
Spiritual,
right side.
Symbolic.
Okay, so the Meiri fusion of physical, the poles, and the spiritual, the contents of the ark. Okay, now we get to my favorite, Rabbi Samson Raphael Hirsch, the leading rabbi of German Jewry in the 19th century, always looking for symbolic explanations and also making it relevant to his day. Remember, he's dealing on one hand with the Enlightenment, people moving away from Judaism, and also the Haredi world, which were against any learning of philosophy and astronomy and science, and you know, being very closed-minded. And he's in between those two worlds, and he writes a commentary on the Torah, and it's in German, so this is a translation of a translation. I looked at the Hebrew and then translated from, and the Hebrew is translation from the German. Okay, so any volunteer to read Rabbi Hirsch?
I guess I'm the reader. The poles of the ark symbolize the purpose and the role to carry the ark and its contents, when necessary, even beyond the limits of a place. The commandment that the poles should never be removed from the ark established in advance for all generations the word of truth, that this Torah and its certificate are not stuck in the ground on which they stood in their holy days and the temple. The constant presence of the poles testifies to this, that the Torah of God is not tied to and needs no special place.
So what he's saying in essence is that the Torah's influence goes beyond any geographical constraints. It can be carried everywhere. You don't need a special land for it, a special country for it. You have no excuse not to live a life of Torah just because you're far away or you're in a different generation. And that's the idea of the poles. So he says they represent portability, and the Torah transcends any geographical barriers. It has, we know it has historically traveled with us everywhere, and it's not bound to any. This is the idea. The poles are, it's always moving. It's always moving. Now I want to extend a little bit his explanation. I think we can look at the poles as suggesting more than that, not just beyond geographical constraints, but also accessibility to the Torah. If the poles are always there, that means they can be carried more easily to anyone. So all people are now are able to access the Torah. It's a dynamic Torah. We can adapt it to all people. There's some people who can study all day, some people more intellectual, some people more emotional, some people need song and dance. So the Torah adapts to all these different people. Some people, you know, the Hasidim, they emphasize dancing, singing, being with the Rebbe, you know, even some questionable practices like believing he has extra powers, which upset a lot of other people. But it's okay. The Torah is dynamic. It's accessible. It's portable. It's another word to say is malleable. And that also means that it has to adapt to the needs of the generation. The problems that faced Hirsch are not the same problems that faced Rashi, are not the same problems that faced the Second Temple people, and certainly not the problems that we face today. But having this idea of the Torah is dynamic and portable means, yes, we can find ways to adapt it to today. We might need to make changes, and we probably need to make changes, but we shouldn't shy away from that. Shouldn't be afraid of doing that. Because, again, the poles are there. The poles are there to symbolize to us. And I say more than that. It's the influence of the Torah goes beyond just study and prayer. And here's where I want to bring in Gershwin. So Gershwin, of course, born Jewish, Gershovitz, father Yaakov Gershovitz, but really had no ties to Yiddishkeit. Wasn't even interested in studying at all. And in high school, he always went to the bars in Harlem and preferred music and sitting there and absorbing the music that he heard there. But there, even a person like Gershwin apparently was influenced by the Torah. And I want to bring in now, I think some of you saw this video, but we have a lot of, we have some new people. And you guys, so not everybody saw this video. How Gershwin's bar mitzvah influenced him in writing a very, very popular song. And the song that we're talking about is this song from the opera Porgy and Bess.
Gather around, children. I'm going to preach y'all a sermon. Bring it on in, folks. Hey, hold up. Listen up. It's a necessary soul.
It's a necessary soul.
The kids at your Bible, to read in that Bible, they ain't necessary soul. The Lord came in was small, but a while.
So the idea, the motif of this song is not everything that's written in the Bible should be taken literally, right? He's teaching them this sermon. Now, how did Yiddishkeit influence this song that, wait, let me mute everybody. There's too much noise. How did Yiddishkeit influence him? So now I want to bring in an Israeli musicologist who gave a fascinating short lecture, it's just 2 minutes, about that song, that very song, how it ties to his Jewish upbringing. Fascinating stuff. So here we go. Let me give the Esther Reed Balsan. What does Gershwin know about what's written in the Tanakh? He didn't agree to sit in school and study. Like I said, he went to the bars. But bar mitzvah, they made him do it. He did have one. And when he stood there on the bima and sang, every boy needs to study that before his haftarah, before getting the aliyah to the Torah. Let's add just two more notes to that melody. So, did you hear that? That's really the origin of the innate necessarily so. The blessing that we say when we get called up to the Torah, she claims, is really based on the and just he added that, tweaked that a little bit. And I think that shows that, you know, the influence of the Torah, this ties into the poles, is beyond the Beit Midrash or the synagogue. Even a person like Gershwin, it influenced him and now and became a hit song in the general culture, all tied to the melody that he sang when he was called up to the Torah in his bar mitzvah, and then becomes a huge hit. So is it really that, you know, I don't know if he ever admitted that that's what influenced him. But I did find on Wikipedia also that explanation that ties the melody of it ain't necessarily so, like she just showed here, which I think is convincing. I think it's very convincing to his bar mitzvah blessed, to the Torah blessings of his bar mitzvah. So now she goes on to sing it, to accompany a singer to sing the whole song. So let's just hear the rest of it and then we'll finish.
It ain't necessarily so.
The things that you're liable to read in the Bible, it ain't necessarily so. Little David was small, but oh my. For he slay Goliath, who lay down and died. Little David was small, but oh my.
Wadu!
Sim-tem-bari-do!
Skadiwa!
Yeah. Oh, Jonah, he lived in a whale.
Oh, Jonah, he lived in a whale.
For he made his home in that fish's abdomen. Oh, Jonah, he lived in a whale. Moses was found in a stream.
little Moses was found in a stream.
By the way, that also supports the theory that it came from, because you see how there's the, what do we call it? When the Chazan says something and we repeat after him, it has a name.
Responsive.
Responsive, yes. It doesn't
antiphonal,
come out.
Antiphonal.
Yeah. So in the, when we saw the original opera, which I showed before, you really saw that. There was the Chazan, and then the whole chorus answered him. That's exactly Baruch Hu Adonai Vorach, and everybody answering. But right? So that supports also the notion that it came from the blessings of the Torah.
He floated on water till old Pharaoh's daughter, she plucked him, she says. From that stream. Wadu!
Wadu!
Zimzambadidu!
Zimzambadidu!
Oliohariwa!
Oliohariwa!
Skadiwa!
Skadiwa!
It ain't necessarily so.
Velo be'echrech kach.
You teach all your children the devil's a villain, but ain't necessarily so. To get into heaven, don't snap for a seven, live clean, don't have no faults like me. Now, I take that gospel whenever it's possible, but with a grain of salt. Methuselah lived 900 years.
Methuselah chai 900 shana bemet.
But who calls that living when no gallow given to no man that's 900 years? I'm preaching this sermon to show it ain't necessary. Ain't Nessa,
very nice. All right. Thank you all for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.